Hi folks, John Blinsky here from CME for Life. Our whole goal is to help you maximize your mind, to really teach you CME, continuing medical education, that you remember for life. This is the last EKG of our series. We will start a new series on Monday. Please stay tuned. So August 18th, rhythm strip and 12-lead EKG interpretation. This was a patient that came on shift, and I was told that there was a patient in the ER who was a young guy with a heart rate of 200. And we knew that the doc who was on had limited critical care skills, limited time taking care of really sick arrhythmias, so I was excited to go down and be a part of this. Upon entering the emergency room, I saw an African-American male who was poorly responsive when I got into the room. He already received two negative chronotropes. He got a beta blocker and calcium channel blocker for what the doc read as a new onset of a rapid AFib. He even called cardiology, and one of the key questions here is it wide complex or narrow complex? And he initially thought this was a narrow complex, and that may have been a little bit concerning, but retrospectively, we don't judge. I mean, we're here to learn and to adequately take care of patients, and that can happen at times. But when I look at this rhythm strip, and here's V6, it clearly is a wide rhythm. So wide complex rhythms got to make me think, well, wow, is this VTAC? Is it something weird? Is there a weird conduction problem? And when you see a wide complex, there's a couple different things that it can be. Now, in my system of interpreting 12-lead EKGs, I use a mnemonic CVS, like cardiovascular system, or it's like a CVS pharmacy. Is it a conduction problem? Is it a ventricular rhythm? Or could it be some systemic problem? When you look at the conduction pathologies, could this be something like a WPW? Could he have a bundle branch block, like a new onset of AFib with aberrant conduction, like a bundle branch block? He doesn't have a pacemaker, so we throw that one out. Could it be VTAC? You can't take that off the table, even though when you look at the morphology, I mean, when I look down here, this almost looks like there may be, is that P wave or T wave? It just doesn't look real, like this looks like VTAC. You can't argue that V6 doesn't look like VTAC, but when I look up here at V5, I see what looks like P wave, so I cannot rule out VTAC. When I look at this as a physician assistant, I go, I can't rule that out yet. That it's not VTAC, but my gestalt is that it is not, especially when I look at what looks like P waves in V5. So when I come back down, could it be a systemic problem? Could it be hyperkalemia? Could it be some kind of toxicologic overdose like DIG or tricyclic antidepressant? What really got my attention, though, was that he received two negative chronotropes and it did not help. Two different classes of a negative chronotrope. When he got the digoxin, so he got a third, what I call a funnel drug. Funnel drugs are beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, and digoxin. They slow down conduction at the AV node, but when he got that third funnel drug, he went into cardiac arrest. He went into a pulseless VTAC. We shocked him back, and he immediately came back with a slow heart rhythm that was textbook WPW. Textbook WPW. Now, WPW, the EKG criteria, is a wide complex QRS, a PR interval that is short, and a delta wave. A delta wave. So if you were looking for a mnemonic and how to remember the EKG criteria for WPW, the mnemonic is WPW. Wide complex, PR short, and a wave, a delta wave. So it looks like this. This is WPW. You have wide complex, PR is short, and this delta wave. Now, if you want to compare and contrast what that delta wave looks like compared to normal, here's a normal QRS with that physiologic Q wave, which represents septal depolarization. Now, the pathophysiology of WPW, when you look at the two circles, you have the SA node up in the atrium. The big circle right in the middle is your AV node. Now, an accessory pathway is like this road here going from the SA node down to the ventricles. And I think about it like the Autobahn in Germany, where you can drive 160 miles per hour, as opposed to the normal conduction going from the SA to the AV node, which you can just drive 50 miles per hour. And you know that the time it takes to go from the SA node to the AV node is 0.12 seconds to 0.2 seconds. Well, this is a fast road, so the conduction is faster than that. So this is your accessory pathway. And when someone's in WPW, impulses either go down the normal road or the fast road. Now, if you use a funnel drug, so if you put a funnel right here in the AV node, what that does is that slows down conduction at the AV node, and that's your beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, and digoxin. When you do that, it sends more impulses down the accessory pathway, and these people actually do worse. So your AV funnel node drugs are like just putting in a funnel right there in your AV node, and that's your beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, and digoxin. So with a rapid WPW, a funnel drug, is detrimental to your patient. Now, there was some wonder. The big question here that I didn't answer well for you was I gave you a rapid tachycardia, so tachyarrhythmia, and I didn't tell you whether it was stable or not. And the high-end providers knew to ask that. John, you didn't give me enough information to answer this question. And by design, absolutely right. You look at this wide complex tachyarrhythmia, and we know that, you know, based on hemodynamic status, if they're hemodynamically unstable, you have to do synchronized cardioversion. And what makes someone unstable? And that's subjective, but to me, it's if I get sphincter sign, if my sphincter tightens up and I think they're going to die if I don't do something. I mean, the American Heart Association talks about shortness of breath, chest pain, altered mental status, hypotension, pulmonary edema. Sure, but if you look at them and say, I think this patient falls under the classification of unstable, synchronized cardioversion is the drug of choice. Shock them, as Amal Mattu says, in an unstable tachyarrhythmia, the drug of choice is propofol. Okay, put them to sleep and do a synchronized cardioversion. When you look at this rhythm, vagal maneuvers are not inappropriate. Adenosine, they now say you can use adenosine for a non-specific wide complex tachyarrhythmia, so that's an option as well for an accessory pathway. I mean, amiodarone is always a go-to medicine. Procainamide is a wonderful option too, but remember, in medicine, we're not cowboys. You know, humility is the god of emergency medicine, so consultation and getting direction from a cardiologist is always wise. So folks, my name is John Belinsky. Thank you for watching The Solution to Week 8. I hope this series has been helpful for you. Please share this with others if you find it helpful. Maximize your mind.